Second.
I have a motion and a second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have approval of the consent agenda.
Move to approve the consent agenda on the amendment.
I have a motion and a second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have public participation. Board members and administrators will listen to concerns and will respond when appropriate by mail or telephone at a later date. The public comment period will not exceed 15 minutes. No individual will be permitted to speak more than once during this period, and each speaker will be allotted no more than 5 minutes. Per policy BDH-1, public participation at board meetings, the following guidelines and procedures will be followed. In order to speak during public participation, a public comment form must be filled out and submitted to the board president prior to the beginning of the meeting. The public comment period will not exceed 15 minutes. No individual will be permitted to speak more than once, and each speaker will be allotted no more than 5 minutes. I don't have any comment cards. Next, we have a report from the superintendent.
Good evening. We're going to take this off again, but I think I'm good. Otherwise, I don't think you'll be able to hear me, and I won't be able to see out of my glasses. Under my report, we do have one note of appreciation in your packet from the Southeast Food Bank, basically thanking you for continuing our Backpack Friday program. Students. Dr. Taylor, we have 55 this year.
Yeah, we have 55.
So, thank you to all the community members that help make donations to make that program possible. It runs entirely off of donations from local businesses and community members. The next item on my report is the technology update. Mrs. Toombs is here this evening, but we're going to try something a little different. So we have a video to show you. I hope it works.
This is the technology that dated in 2022. In the technology department, our mission is to provide technology to create success in CTV-1-2 school district and beyond. It is our goal to maintain an infrastructure for technology to achieve success in an efficient manner, provide the tools and resources necessary for teaching and learning, provide communication tools to meet the needs of our students, staff, and parents, provide professional development for our staff that is meaningful and timely, be mindful of budgetary constraints in the district. In our goal one, that covers the infrastructure of our school district. The backbone is to maintain all the switches, wireless and wiring that our students need to be successful using their Chromebooks. We add and upgrade where the needs are each year. Our internet bandwidth is configured for telephone, and we use the Charter Spectrum system. Over the summer, we updated some wireless access points in our parking lot so that students can pull into the parking lot and access our wireless system at any time. Our content filtering is receiving filtering Bill Guardian, the students' activity. Safety. Students and staff must be in a safe environment for teaching and learning to take place. We maintain the door and car readers and video surveillance. Our door and car system was recently upgraded over the summer. And we do maintain an off-site backup system for all of our critical systems. Each student is issued a Chromebook, grades K-12. Our new purchase of Chromebooks this year covered grades K-1. All of our Chromebooks are touchscreen Chromebooks. And the Chromebooks were also issued to all aides as well as teachers. The projection devices in every room and any places necessary or requested is provided. We utilize smart boards for mediums, tablets, etc. for input as may be requested. We also have monopads and some smart TVs, and they are being utilized in classes in larger areas. The software that our teachers and students use is mainly located online. All of our textbooks are online. Google Classroom, Moodle, and other learning management systems that teachers use are also online. We also help support the video broadcasting crew by upgrading their systems as necessary. In the Library Media Center, we support and upgrade any and all their systems as necessary. The Z spaces, for instance, are going to be upgraded in the upcoming months in the libraries. We also maintain Identikid, which is our visitor management system. It checks visitors with the sex offender registries and alerts admin when there is any issue for resolution. We also have some specialized software, which is our PowerSchool Special Program software, Destiny, and OverDrive for the library. We use Google Apps for Education. We have United Streaming for Discovery Education, which is online videos used to enhance the curriculum. And we also maintain a Sabar Montage server, which provides other online video services specifically geared towards education. Goal number three is communication tools. Each teacher and student has a dedicated email account for them to use. We use the Google G Suite, which encompasses a host of communication tools. We utilize Google Classroom. We share documents, spreadsheets, and presentations with each other so that we can work in real time. We also do videos throughout various outlets, including Zoom. And we have access to other tools as necessary. For the general public and parents, we have our social media website that is hosted through Aptigy. It incorporates a website, social media, and a school app. We use push notifications, a calling system, and texting system to reach our parents and inform the public of things that are happening in our school district. We also have PowerSchool, which is a great tool for parents and teachers to communicate grades, attendance, fees, and lunch balances. We have an integrated online payment system, and we use the eCollect system in PowerSchool to collect yearly information for parents. Other communication tools we use are announcements on videos, on the TVs in every school. Most of those are student-run, which gives students more skills in real-world applications. We have the video creation groups in the middle school and both elementary schools. And the high school has the DLP crew, which runs the video boards and video creation. Additional software is our SNAP system, which is the nursing system, and they track things that students need on their medical needs. We have the accounting software, which for all things financial. And our employees utilize WebLink, which has an online employee financial system tracking. An inventory system. And we use a Kaseya server, which helps us monitor our Windows computers, which includes antivirus software and our work order system. Additional software we have is our online archive system with K-12 Docs. It is all online and accessible. Our frontline management system, which does our sub-calling system and request for leave tracking. And also KidAccount, elementary tracking of car line and release of students at the end of the day down in our elementary here in town. All of that pick up through the bridge is run through KidAccount. We have our eMIDS program, which is a two-year program. We're finishing our second year in this cohort. Since the coronavirus, we were sidetracked a bit. We will continue this fall and finish up. This program focuses on hands-on instruction with the integration of technology. And the teachers who attend this can receive college credit through Missouri Baptist University. We're also going to offer other online class opportunities for our teachers. And as a tech department, we do some training as well. We are a member of the ISTE, International Society for Technology Education. And we usually attend a couple of conferences throughout the year, but those, again, have been sidetracked because of the coronavirus, and we'll pick those up as they become available. Our goal five is to remain within a budget that's set by the district. And we have a tech budget, which is supported by the people of the St. John County. We would not have near what we have had our wonderful community not supported our endeavors in the tech department. We have wonderful administration support. And we work to keep it within our means. We seek grants as well to maintain and upgrade what we do have. And we also try to fulfill teacher requests within reason. We also try to look to the future for what's next and how to stay on budget with those requests. And that wraps up our technology for the 2020 and 2021 school year. Thank you so much. In the technology department, our mission is to...
Very nice, Mrs. Tooth.
Very good.
She is here if you have any questions for her.
She's amazing. If you ever need her, she's always there.
But how many devices are you responsible for?
Good evening, everyone. We had our September Professional Development Day on September 4th, and the Professional Development Committee thought it was very important to poll the teachers to see what they needed. So a couple weeks before, they sent out emails at the building level to ask them what was most important to them. Do they need tech training? Do they need time in their classrooms? Do they need collaboration time? Overwhelmingly, at all levels, they said they needed time to work in their classroom. We're a couple weeks in at that point, and it can get a little bit overwhelming when you don't have time in the day to fit everything in. So the Professional Development Committee thought it was very important to build that time into our schedule that day. Our paraprofessionals have required training videos that they watched, and we have to do some collaboration time with our partner teachers. We had some NWEA training with our K-2 teachers. They're new to that this year. Our 3 to 5 teachers did some planning for NWEA testing. And then all our other teachers, it was collaboration time and time to work in your classroom. We sent out a survey to determine how successful our back-to-school professional development days were, as well as the September 4th. I'll have that data for you next month. They have till Friday to fill that out. So overall, I think they appreciated the time to work and attempt to, I don't know that they did get caught up, but attempt to get caught up, attempt to plan for future lessons, get back on track, and hopefully a chance to bring them. So that was our day in September.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm excited to actually be able to be here in person and share some of the highlights of our in-person learning that occurred over the last few weeks. This first slide highlights just some of the excitement that was captured. Our PTO purchased a Welcome Back Dragon sign. We had a local business that wanted to do some advertising, so she purchased the We Love Our Students sign, and so teachers were able to sign up and socially distance their students and bring them out for photos. And then we have, in the upper left-hand corner, we have our kindergarten classrooms. We have the plexiglass sneeze guards, so they're able to take off their masks because They're five, and that's difficult. They're going to be held fast on all day. This year, we had to do open house a little differently. At first, we weren't going to do one at all. And then the kindergarten teacher said, please, 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 we need to meet our kids in some way, shape, or form. And so on the 19th, throughout the day and the evening, they schedule 10 to 15 minute appointments, very much like a parent-teacher conference. And then the families came in one at a time. They disinfected. They went out the other exit. But that way, the students got to see their classrooms. They got to meet the teacher, and they knew who they were looking for on the first day of school. And then our preschool and early childhood also did that as well. Then on the 20th, the other grade levels, and even kindergarten and preschool and early childhood did this as well, they created virtual open house presentations, and we worked with Mrs. Toombs, who created the middle diagram there, and it was an interactive link, and then we worked with Ms. Otto. She put that on our school website so that families could go there, and we did a push notification to let them know they were there. And this year's trend is the Bitmoji presentations. So each teacher had like a Bitmoji of themselves, and when you clicked on their Bitmoji, it took them to their presentation and the information was there. So they found a way to make it work. And then we've been trying to keep things as normal as possible in the elementary and not forget to do some of those special things that elementary kids love to do. So on 9/11, we celebrated Patriot Day by wearing our red, white, and blue, and the teachers did many activities to, in a kid-friendly way, teach them about 9/11. And then today was International Dot Day. That's the dot dress that I'm wearing. And so we snapped a few pictures of our kiddos that participated. And we were very fortunate to have 7 positive office referrals during these first 3 weeks of school. But I noticed when I was putting this together, they're all boys. They are all boys. So we had Nolan Ram, Jason Hurst, Jacob Fehrenberg, Seth Meener, William Roller, Trent Strader, and Jace Frawley. So we challenged the ladies today to step it up. And I wanted to highlight that Stephanie Sulzer received the MRTA grant for her grant, Find Your Voice, which allowed her to purchase 2 microphones that they could throw to one another, and then also microphones that they could use for their public speaking, and then the district matched her funds. So she's going to buy some additional materials, and then Ms. Sulzer graciously said that she would allow other teachers to sign up those materials and use them as well. And then I added one extra slide than what I was supposed to, but we did our teacher and super staff. And our Chocolate Cheers recipients were Jody Nagger and Amelia Woodenmeyer. And they both received numerous nominations for helping out and lending a helping hand during the first few weeks of school. That's St. Genevieve Elementary.
A big check came in for lunch money donations, and we just kind of started with the kid that had the most negative balance and paid that off for those kids, so that was much appreciated. We had the local church bring us donuts and offer prayers for us, so the community has been very supportive. We appreciate it. And then I just put pictures of all the activities we've been doing. They continued on the Chromebooks as usual. We started the NWEA testing, kindergarten through fifth grade. It's amazing, even kindergartners can get on there and do the test, and it shows how much they know already and where we can start our teaching process. principal, Kelly Everly, thank you very much. We almost dressed exactly alike one day. She had the opposite colors I did, so that's how well we're working together right now. Open house, we did, we're smaller, so I kind of opened it up to all grade levels. If you want to do it in person, you can do it in person. And we'll just kind of stagger the times and work it out. And really, pre-K, K, 1, 2, 3, and even 4 was kind of saying, can we? And I had to limit it. So I limited it to pre-K through 2nd grade, did it in person, open house. And then 3, 4, and 5 did virtual. But even pre-K through 2 created a virtual link that the parents could go to. And like Monica said, they all love the Bitmojis right now. And some of them are pretty cute. I mean, like, if you look at them, they really look like teachers. Then I just wanted to highlight some pictures of the first day of school. I mean, the kids are happy and learning is taking place and the teachers are showing them that they care about them and kids are having fun. Here's some more activities. We're still doing small group work. We're just wearing the mask. When we can be 6 feet apart, we're not wearing our mask. Social distancing when we can. But students are loving it. They're having fun and happy to be there each day. We had our new student welcome. We had, I think it's 36 new students, which is kind of a lot for us. So we had new student welcomes outside on the picnic tables, and they brought blankets and towels, and we sat outside and gave them ice cream. Miss Rowland led that. And then the picture, the second one from the left, is our Lighthouse students. They came and they talked to the new students about how Bloomsdale Elementary was, and they showed them around. Kind of like the partners in the classroom, so they'll take care of them when they need to. And then we had Patriots Day on September 11th. And again, we're just trying to be as normal as we can and continue with all of the activities we normally do. And that's Bloomsdale Elementary.
Let's be honest, you've missed us, haven't you?
Oh, absolutely.
We've missed you guys, too, because good administrators will never miss an opportunity to brag on their buildings. So we thank you for giving that back to us.
Oh.
We've missed you guys, and we've missed the opportunity to talk about the good things that are going on. I start off this evening with a gift for you. Mrs. Womack asked me to deliver the St. Genevieve Middle School yearbooks. I've left those at your seats. I hope that you'll enjoy those, and I think you'll find that Mrs. Womack and her students have done an excellent job, as always. She had an interesting challenge this year because we're already contracted to fill a certain number of pages, but we only had 75% of them in school year last year. But she's done an amazing job of finding things to celebrate, students to highlight, programs to share with you, and I hope that you'll enjoy it. It's good to be back. It's nice to see the smiles on the faces, and we do see those smiles. We're not masked all day, thank goodness. We like to give our students a break when we can, when we're able to distance. And so I've shared with you some pictures of some of the things that have been going on. You can see we've got a lot of happy students. I think they're glad to be back as well. At the top left, you can see Mrs. Meyer on a Zoom meeting with some of her students in a counseling meeting. In the center, in the pink shirts, are our middle school buddies who helped us out quite a bit with our incoming sixth graders. On the far right is Reagan working on an engineering project in Mrs. Koenig's class. And at the bottom is a sort of a little montage that Mrs. Huffman made to show what school looks like these days. So I hope you'll enjoy those pictures. We have already had some positive office referrals too. We're up to 10, in fact. And one of the really interesting things I found about this list was that about half of the students that you see are not even live in-school students. But they were recognized because they have taken on the challenges of distance learning and have really mastered it. They've taken to it well. They're performing at levels that we would hope for in middle school students, but in ways that we thought deserved a little extra recognition. In the photos at the top left, you have Camille Campbell. She's brand new to our district. In fact, she received her positive office referral on the second day of school. Is that right, Mr. Schweitz? And she has come right in and made herself at home and is making friends and showing us just exactly how smart she is. So we're glad to have her at St. Edmund School. Next to her is Riley Depp, followed by Rihanna Gretzmacher, Aiden Harville, Evan Kemper, and at the bottom, Ryder Keeser, Libby Smith, Chase Snell, Levi Sutton, and Ben Waltz. Let's talk about where we've been, what we've accomplished so far. We did have sixth grade orientation. We were able to divide those students into multiple groups so that we could safely distance, but we felt that sixth grade orientation was important enough that we couldn't cancel it. We wanted those students to have an opportunity to meet some of their classmates, to meet their teachers, and to see the buildings too. We were able to pull that off, again, with the help of the buddies, with the help of the teachers, Mrs. Meyer, of course, and that was a successful day. I'm thankful that we went forward with it. We also did our usual back-to-school class meetings, which would normally take place in the old middle school gym and gives us an opportunity to just review the rules, welcome the students back, let them get to know us a little bit. But we did those online, and the photos that you see there are just screen grabs from what those online meetings looked like. There was a portion that I covered, one for Mrs. Huffman as well, Mr. Draper, and Mrs. Meyer. And one thing that I liked about that is that now those are saved in time, and we can revisit those if we need to. If students had questions, if parents had questions, or if we have incoming students that weren't here when we held those meetings, we can always share those with those students in the future. We've also had a few of the drills that we start with. Professional development, of course, as Dr. Taylor explained to you. Some revisions in our emergency plans, which I think you'll get to peek at tonight. And then last week we started with, this week actually, started with NWEA testing in math. And NWEA, just to remind you, is a through-year assessment. We take one test in the fall, one in the winter, one in the spring, so that we can watch growth, we can identify strengths and weaknesses, modify instruction if we need to, and help our students reach their potential. It's a good predictor of MAP performance, and so in that sense, it's an important test because it gives us some really good data. And MAP decided this year to be the Intrepid Explorers who went first, and so they're underway with that right now. These days, this is where we are. We have a new textbook series with online supplements in ELA. They have the hardback books already. The online supplements are ready to go. They're just waiting to pick out a training date. There's a new online learning system in social studies through Discovery Education. Those guys were trained on that shortly before the March closure. So I know they're anxious to get their kids enrolled in there and start using that system really for the first time. Even though we've had it for 7 or 8 months, they're just now getting to jump in with that. We also have a bank of virtual reality viewers that we're ready to launch in social studies. I will talk to young Mr. McDaniel and see if he would be willing to come down and give you guys a demonstration. I think you'll find they're a lot of fun and there's a lot of learning potential in those too. And that's really the important part, isn't it? And we're also examining best practices for clubs, lead groups, tutoring, trying to figure out how we can get some effective time out of those but still maintain safe distancing and proper protocol for those too. And then finally, lunch detention, which seems like an odd thing to celebrate. But if you'll think about it from my point of view, we found a way to give our students an alternative in the discipline system that doesn't take them away from class time. And as you can imagine, we're all very protective of class time these days, especially when we only get to see them a couple of times a week. So we've been able to work that out. We haven't used any yet, but that is an option that we can use now before we take the step of going on to ISS and asking those students. So that's where we've been and where we are. Let's talk about where we're going. NWEA testing continues right now with math, and ELA will pick that up next week, followed by reading shortly thereafter. School pictures have been scheduled. We're going to do those over 2 different days because that's what we have to do these days in order to catch all of our students. For middle school, those are in early October, and we have those dates on our events calendar, and therefore they'll pop up on the homepage too. Our teachers are working on SLO and professional development plan preparations. Those will be due very soon. And I know they're putting some good work and careful thought into those. And then, of course, homecoming week coming up here very shortly. More COVID-specific type things, we do have a virtual open house also. We worked on putting the finishing touches on that today, and you'll see that launch probably tomorrow. I just want somebody to help me click through it a few more times just to make sure we have all the glitches covered. But I'm really impressed with the work that the teachers put into it, into creating their pages too. And I publicly thank elementary for the inspiration. It was fabulous, but we had to work pretty hard in order to keep up with them. And then finally, I want to talk about the same page. This is a document that I'm working on with the help of some people who are much smarter than me to make sure that the communication that we share with parents, for example, with the board members, for example, with teachers, for example, with students, for example, is shared among all of those groups. What we find is that someone may come with a question and I'm able to answer that question, and in the future I think to myself, I've already answered that, but I might have already answered that for only a specific group. So we are literally going to get everybody onto the same page, and the document is going to be called The Same Page. And it'll talk about what expectations are for academics, what a Friday should look like, how digital learning should look, so that teachers can see the same things that I've told the parents, they can see the same things that I've told the students. We're literally getting on the same page, and I hope to have that ready to launch by the end of the week. Finally, I want to leave you with a thought, compliments of Mrs. Huffman. I'm sure you've heard before that it's not hard because you're doing it wrong, it's hard because you're doing it right. This year we're saying it's not hard because you're doing it wrong, it's hard because it's hard. And that's where we are this year. But I can't imagine being as successful as we have been with any other group. And that runs from the very top of the district, thank you, all the way down through every employee in all of these buildings. Whether they're in the classroom, or they're in the cafeteria, or they're on a bus, or it's the parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and guardians working with their students at home and those students themselves and the supportive community. We just have a beautiful recipe here that works well to help make us successful. And I think I speak on behalf of all of us when I say thank you for being part of that team. And thank you to the community and our parents and our students for being part of that team. Dr. Moy?
I saw lots of excitement, and I'm assuming that is because I'm here and Mr. Haney's not.
That's right.
And even if it's not, that's what we're going to tell him. So, I wanted to start the high school presentation this evening. I had an opportunity to travel with the cross-country team, and a lot of you guys know that that group is very near and dear to my heart. My wife still has an opportunity to coach, and I just get a chance to get out and spend some time going to meets and getting to see those athletes and getting to see them run. And so Levi Wiegand actually went to the meet this weekend and pulled some pictures. And I wanted to share those with you guys because it really touched me. It was an opportunity for our students to get back to a sense of normalcy. And I felt like that piece was so important. I was so impressed with the snapshots that he was able to garnish from the meet and just to see through his eyes what things were like. It was really, really neat and really cool. So you see the smiles of the boys after they had finished the race. It was very different riding the bus with all of the students masked on the bus and watching them not have any interaction. It was very different. But to see the smiles, to see them compete, to see them have an opportunity to be able to do those things, it was truly amazing and truly awesome weekend. I also wanted to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Nix. He's been amazing through all of this. He's had several wrinkles and several different things that have come up that he's had to work through on an athletic standpoint. He's been truly amazing, working with limited crowds and figuring out how all of this can work to try to protect our kids and keep them in the game, keep them competing on the football field on Friday nights, in the gym for volleyball, out on the golf course, and our cross-country kids as well. He's been truly amazing, so I definitely wanted to take an opportunity to thank him for all of his hard work, the phone calls that he's had to take, and just the way that he's handled all of these situations has been remarkable. So September, we had a Rotary Student of the Month, and this is Quentin Ponder, and we started a tradition where the student gets an opportunity to take a faculty member with them. And Quentin decided that he was going to take his grandma, which is Joan Ponder, who works for the district. And so I saw Quentin this morning in the comments, and I knew that we were going to highlight Quentin in our Rotary Student of the Month. And I went over to Quentin this morning, and I wanted just to kind of get the lowdown of how the experience was, what kind of meal he got, and so he just started talking. And it was really neat to get an opportunity to see what he had to share. He was talking about the meatloaf and mashed potatoes that he got for lunch, which then transcended into, I really wanted to get, why did you take Joan, or why did you take Grandma with you to Rotary Student of the Month? And he wants to talk about all of these things, but he did finally come around and answer that he wanted to take Joan with him because she's been such an influence in his life, and really kind of one of the reasons why he's considering and thinking about getting into education is because of Grandma. So one of the things when they get to the Rotary Student of the Month and they're asked to present and have a conversation about what they want to do in the future, Quentin talked about education. And for those of you guys that know anything about Quentin, he loves Rubik's Cubes, and he's very, very good at Rubik's Cubes. He times himself, and he'll sit in the commons before school and see how fast he can do it, and then he'll do it again and see how fast he can do it. And so he made this analogy in his presentation and talked about Rubik's Cubes and wanting to get into education because he learned how to master the Rubik's Cube by watching. And he said so much of education is watching how things unfold and watching how things happen and learning in that regard. And so he wants to have the opportunity to be able to share that with others, and that's one of the reasons why he's considering going into education. Over on the right, I did want to highlight Mrs. Drury. She works very closely with our Rotary Interact Club and has a ton of connections as our students go to the Rotary Student of the Month, coordinating, figuring all of those things out, as does Mr. Toombs as our senior counselor. He works with those students, gets them prepped. He was actually out today getting a headshot of Quentin so that way we could get a press release and get that out to the newspaper. So Mr. Toombs works extremely hard in that regard as well, just getting things set up. I do know right before we came in for the meeting, the Elks Student of the Month was also announced, and that is Sydney Bumgardner. I don't have any additional information on Sid because it literally came out. Mr. Toombs sent out that email right before I saw it right before we came into the meeting. So I did want to highlight Sid as well. Over the summer, they announced that Mr. Bonnell and Mr. Roth were the Girls District 1 Wrestling Coaches of the Year. This is something that I've been able to see the impact that these two individuals have had on a lot of our male wrestlers over the years. And we started our girls wrestling program a couple years ago. And both of these two individuals have just taken off, and they've been a huge impact for our kids in the high school. Just the role model and the way that they work with kids. I've seen Mr. Roth when I coached cross country. He would come in the mornings, and this truly made an impact with me, was in working with kids at 6 o'clock in the morning. And cross country runners get up and they get out and they get on the roads early in the morning, but to see him and see the impact that he was having on kids at an early time in the morning and sacrifices that he was making truly impressed me, and just the relationships that they have. So I got an opportunity to travel with them to go to the district wrestling tournament this year. I actually traveled and watched the boys one weekend and the girls the following weekend. So it was really neat to get to see the differences. But the really amazing thing about them earning the Girls District Wrestling Coach of the Year is the fact that there are no classifications in girls wrestling right now. So in District 1, we're wrestling against schools the size of Eureka and St. Genevieve are all wrestling in the same area. Hillsboro, a lot of schools that are much larger than us, and these two individuals not only win the Coach of the Year, but they also win the Assistant Coach of the Year, which I think is very, very remarkable. So, Mrs. Geck stole my thunder a little bit, but the MRTA grant recipient for the high school, Mrs. Tracy Romer, and I had an opportunity to talk to Tracy this morning about her plans to spend that money in the direction that she wants to go. She talked about getting in and purchasing graphic novels for her classroom. She also talked about working with Mrs. Polite, and it sounds like they're going to purchase a transition game that they want to use with their students. And then also the money that's left over she wants to put back into technology in the event that something crazy happens this fall. She wants to make sure that she has her ducks in a row and make sure that she has great opportunities for her students from a technology standpoint. So Mrs. Romer was very excited when I came up this morning. She had a big smile on her face just getting an opportunity to talk to her. Very thankful, very appreciative of the money, very appreciative of the matching that the district puts in and just an opportunity to be able to give back and share with her students. Dr. Etherton and Dr. Fleek actually got an opportunity to present her a plaque for her Lifetime Achievement Award that she received from the Missouri Educators Family and Consumer Sciences. And this is just truly remarkable, and I had an opportunity to talk to Dr. Etherton about this in the last couple of days and just kind of pick her brain. She doesn't like the limelight. She doesn't like asking a lot of questions. So as I started to kind of dig in, she said, let me send you a video. And then she found a couple of, she reached out, and actually a couple of videos came, and they highlighted a lot of Dr. Etherton's contributions that she's made to family and consumer sciences and throughout her career. And I think that's the most impressive part of this. It's not something that's happened in a year. It's not something that's happened in a couple of years. It's her entire career that she's being recognized for. And so I just have a couple of bulleted items that showed up in both of those videos that I thought was very impressive. They talked about her technology integration that she has in the classroom that she began all the way back in the early 2000s, working on getting grants approved and going that direction and trying to increase the technology opportunities that she has for students, the dual credit opportunities that she's worked so very, very, very hard to get the CDA program and working with Monroe Area College to get chances for our students not only to get into the preschool and to work in that atmosphere, but also to earn dual credits and that opportunity for students going forward. So they talked a lot about the dual credit and the technology. One of the comments or one of the quotes that was in there is that she leads the charge with area FACTS teachers. She's a role model, and she's someone that a lot of the area FACTS teachers will pick up the phone and they'll send emails to reach out to find out how things are going in St. Genevieve. How is Dr. Etherton doing things? And so that quote really stuck out to me about leading the charge. She served on numerous national board positions, and then also she was recognized for the National Association for Career and Technical Education Honor Roll, and that was the second video that she sent. And actually, her being as humble as she is, she sent that and she said, oh my goodness, there's another video that's out there. She reached out to somebody, they sent her one video, and then they followed up with another video that was out there that she was unaware of. So she's truly remarkable. It's fantastic to see the body of work that she's put into things and how she's gone about really integrating that technology and bringing those dual credit opportunities to our students over the course of her entire career. And then finally, we'll end with FCCLA, which also goes in with Dr. Etherton. Over the summer, they had an opportunity in order to be able to compete in the National Star Event competition. They had to do things differently this year. It was a virtual competition. The students competed first at a regional competition, then they moved on to the state competition, and then finally the national competition. And these three students, starting on the left is Emily Abt, and she was a graduating senior for us in 2020. She finished 11th in the nation, earned a gold rating in event management. And then Maria Kemper and Drew Newman had an opportunity to also compete in the virtual competition, and they placed 4th in the nation, earned a gold rating in their digital stories for change. So it's truly remarkable to see the impact not only that Dr. Etherton has had with that, but also as she has expanded into FCCLA and the job that she does for our kids just each and every day. I also wanted to take an opportunity, just as Dr. Mercer said, just to thank you guys. Thank you guys for your hard work, your efforts, everything that you guys do for us. I know that the start of the school year has been amazing to have kids back in the building. It's been great to see some of you guys pop in the building and just to see people again, to see you guys and your hard work to be here, to be physically present. I want to thank you guys for that and everything that you guys do.
Thank you.
workers, employees necessary to support educators and students, transportation, teachers, essential workers. We have a limited number of subs this year, so using this essential worker status is very important to keep our buildings open. So basically, this means educated people that work here that have been told to quarantine have the option, and they're not required to go ahead and come to work. But if the contact that they've had is that the person that tested positive lives there, or they have tested and they're awaiting results, or there's a whole list here. If they're in that category, the essential worker option of working is not, they can't do it. They have to quarantine, they have to stay home, and they have to stay around their kids. If they're just on quarantine and their contact lives outside their home and they're not showing any symptoms, they can't come to work. They're required to wear at least at a minimum 2-ply masks and a face shield at all times. They're required to enforce social distancing, so they need to maintain 6 feet and stay away from everyone. They are to check symptoms and take their temperature before they come to work, and then when they get to work during their planned time or when they have a break, they are required to go to the nurse in their building and to have a temperature check and to go through the symptoms list again during the day. At the end of the school day, if they have an after school duty, like bridge duty or helping a kid, and they're close contacts, parents picking up their kids, we are not letting them do the after school duty. But in the high school, one of the duties is like parking lot duty, where you're not really around kids. So we're kind of taking that case by case, and really limiting those after school activities too. So, that is basically a quick summary of the essential workers information. So if anyone has any information, go online, look at the plan. It's an entire page that really lays it all out. The next item in the plan that was updated was a food service program. It's called Seamless Summer Option. It's the program that we use to offer meals, free meals, to children in the community that were ages 3 to 18, and we did those from March to May. An option became available several weeks ago to make an application to apply to extend that to December 31st. So we submitted the application, Jordan Mueller filled it out and submitted it. We've been approved to continue that program. So starting on Monday, all of our students at St. Jim are getting breakfast and lunch for free. Anyone in the community with a child ages 3 to 18 gets a form that you need to fill out, and you can come pick up breakfast and lunch for your child for free. If your child, like at the middle school and high school, on A day your child is at home, your child can come and get that meal. They just need to bring their lunch card. If your child does not go to school here, we just need you to fill out that online form. So, like I said, it started yesterday. The numbers have already grown a little bit, so we're just trying to get the information out. I do believe there was an article that went to the paper the other year.
Yep, yeah. It was in there this week.
So that is a new program. We're excited. We will continue that through December 31st or until the federal funds run out. It is important for those families that qualify for free reduced lunches to go ahead and submit that application now and be approved. So when this program does stop, we're not, their child is not eating and building these balances because we don't have the free and reduced lunch applications yet. contact with those people if something changes in our community that does not allow them to use a facility and have a practice or whatever. So those are the updates to the reopening plan. Again, Ms. Otto's doing a great job.
Yes.
She put all this together. It looks fantastic. And she does a very good job pushing all this information out. So. And then we have one additional report. So I'm pretty excited about this report because I have Patty Taylor and Christian Keemer to be here to talk to you about homecoming. Student Council, our high school student council officers did a presentation to the admin team and made the request for what homecoming is going to look like. So I'm going to turn it over to them and let them tell you about it.
Okay, so this year's homecoming is obviously going to be very, very different considering the circumstances. Going into this, we wanted to keep any sort of sense of normalcy that we could. We talked to a lot of students throughout our building. We even talked to a few middle school students. I have a brother in middle school who had a few opinions on it as well. And what we came out with all of this is that we just wanted a sense, an opportunity to come together. It was very, very important to us, seeing as though a lot of us are Monday, Wednesday, and a few of us are on Tuesday, Thursday. There's not really a chance for all of us to come together on one day or one event and be together as a school. It's been very, very difficult for seniors, especially the ones that I've talked to feel like you can really enjoy this year. So going into this, student council, especially the officers, really wanted to put our all into this and to focus on these aspects that would bring us together as a school.
Okay, so we're gonna have some activities throughout the week of homecoming to keep it normal like how it usually is, but they're a lot different this year. So we're doing a food drive, and all the sponsors are collecting their own per class, and we're also doing a hall decorating, which lasts through this weekend and then a couple days of school after school. And then scavenger hunt, that's up in the air right now, that hasn't been completed. And then we have our spirit week dress up days. It's jersey day Monday and Tuesday, and then tie-dye Wednesday, Thursday, and then Friday is green and white. And then for Powerpuff, we're making students earn points because this year parade was not an option to maintain our distance. And so on the next slide, we have our list of everything about Powderpuff.
So Powderpuff is a very interesting opportunity that the girls of the junior and senior classes have in the year to go out and sort of rough each other up. It's supposed to be flag football. Those rules aren't really followed at some points. So you can imagine that this is a very important event to the junior and senior girls. Typically, the way that our girls are able to participate is they earn a certain amount of hours by participating in float building. That was not an option this year, and our health department recommended that we, very strongly recommended that we not have a parade because of the amount of people it draws. So that certainly presented a setback to us, and so we decided that a fun way for us to sort of get into the spirit of homecoming and earn points as well would be to decorate hallways. So certain areas of the school have been delegated to different classes. Seniors, I believe, are the math hallway. I'm not sure the specific hallway, but each class has been delegated a certain area that they get to decorate on specific days. And that way they're able to earn points for this advanced Powderpuff. So that's also gonna look very different. Typically, we have some boy football players act as coaches. This year, to minimize the amount of people on the sidelines, we're ruling that out. And so it's gonna be very interesting. We're also not having practices, so we're really just gonna toss out on the field and see what happens. It's going to be very fun. We're going to have our sponsors on the sidelines, and anyone who is not on the field actually playing is going to be wearing a mask or a gaiter to minimize contact.
Okay, so Friday at 1:30, we're going to have a homecoming assembly. Keep it normal. So students, if they want to come attend, they can come. And then we're going to have every other section blocked off with caution tape just to help with social distancing. And then just like football games and how we're doing powder puff, you have to wear your mask until you're seated. And then for the football game, we, like students now, haven't really been able to go to the games. Some have, but not all of them. So this game, we're going to open all students. Like, anybody can come in for students, but they have to sit on the grassy hill. And then we're going to have chairs set up. Or they'll have to bring their own lawn chair in, and you'll be 6 feet apart. And then for coordination, we thought this year would be a really good idea to provide them with some cadets and masks.
And the
cup assembly is where? 1:30 on the
football field. So this was our very, very big challenge going into this year. Obviously, we had a very large amount of people that were very apprehensive about having cave dance this year, which is understandable. After what this school faced last year with being faced with not giving our seniors a prom or a graduation, it's very, very scary. And a lot of anxiety from admin and, of course, the seniors going into this about what a dance could potentially cost. So there was a lot of work put in. I know Christian and I put in a lot of work, and our other officers have been great, especially our sponsors, Mr. Schweiss and Ms. Reed, have been really great about collaborating with us and putting in this extra time to do as much as we can to make this happen. So what we came up with, we went into our administration meeting with kind of a bare bones plan, kind of what we wanted to see. We wanted to feel each other out and get an idea of what we wanted and what admin was comfortable with as well. So that meeting was extremely helpful to everybody involved. I think we got a much better understanding of where everybody was. After that meeting, student council took it upon themselves to contact the county health department and get further recommendations based on what they thought would be best for the school while also trying our best to bring everybody together. So in the end, we did get final approval from Mr. Haney and from administration for the dance, which is an enormous win for us. I know spirits were very, very low when we were faced with the idea of not having this dance. So the fact that we get to have this with the cooperation from the administration is really fantastic, and we could not be more excited. So for Saturday's dance, the outlines that we came up with, rather than having it in the gym as we typically do, it's going to be an outside dance. This will open it up extremely. We're going to have a lot of open space for people to social distance. From the county health department, we talked to them, and they recommended multiple sanitizing stations in common areas so that students are more encouraged to wash their hands. And when they don't do that, they'll use hand sanitizer. Typically, we allow outside dates to the dance, and that's not going to be a possibility this year. We're also shortening it from 7 to 10 to 8 to 10 p.m. We talked about lowering the amount of money tickets would cost, but we decided in the end that if we kept it at $10, this would allow us to also purchase a face shield for each person that is going to the dance. So we're actually ordering those face shields. We're in the process of ordering them off Amazon, and we found them in bulk, and we figured out that if we kept it at $10, we could also include a face shield for everybody involved. We also talked to the health department, and they recommended that we have reminder signs to encourage hand washing and social distancing and that kind of thing throughout the
field. Okay, so for the dance, to limit the things coming in and out, we're just going to offer some bottled water, no food or drink. And then as they walk in, check their temperature, and then if anything's outrageous over the line, then they won't be able to come in. And then we're going to encourage people to be like aware of year round. So like, when you're out on the football field, to know like who's around you so that if anything would ever happen, you know I was around that person. And then whenever, like usually we have tables set up in the gym so you can sit down and drink your water or whatever. And we don't have tables out there, so we're going to have the bleachers open and then tape off every other section so it's social distance. And then we thought it'd be a good idea to call it the masquerade dance because masks are mandatory to get in.
Lastly, we just wanted to say thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to present you guys with our plan. This would not at all have been possible without cooperation. while also keeping us safe and making us feel as one. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Saying you won't get it this year, but do it next year. And there's some big teachers in different districts, they've won it 3 years in a row. So it's worth pursuing. It's $500, folks, matching along with the district. So there's one district, even the bus driver got a grant. It can be a custodian, administrator, I mean, the whole bit. It's worth pursuing. This way, and we do our fundraising by raising money to allow these grants to be awarded to the teachers or employees of the district. So, go for it. Congratulations to the three people that got it.
Next, we have unfinished business, emergency procedures.
We spent a lot of time last year updating the emergency operations plan. Bailey Otto was involved in that, Gina Lytle, Christine Clark, Stephanie Gay. It was time last year to update it and to bring it in to today's language. Some new procedures and some new suggestions. So having spent all that time last year updating that plan, looking at it again this year and reviewing issue was much easier. It's a 116-page document. So we updated faculty, we updated a couple sections that Mrs. Gay changed some wording on. But it's really the same plan as last year. You approved it last year before the pandemic, and it has a pandemic section in it. Now we have a pandemic document that's much more detailed, much more extensive. So I would ask that you approve operations.
I'll move to approve the updates to the district emergency procedures.
Second. I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. And I just want to share that
tattoo.
Next, we have bus routes for 2020-2021.
Yes. So the bus routes are in the binder that we keep at district office. I have them here. I did scan all of them and upload them for you last week. So you do have, you did have access to them ahead of this meeting to review them. There is a letter in there from Mike Jokers. I counted the routes, and we have 34 routes. So this includes our Career Center bus that goes down to Perryville every morning when Perryville's open. The special education routes and the early childhood special education buses. We did have four route changes. Route 1 decreased 6 miles. Route 29, we have discontinued that right now because we moved them onto the challenge route, and that's why the challenge route has increased 14 miles because there weren't very many kids on either one of those routes, so we're now, we can find them. The hope that when we're able, if we're able to go back and have all the kids on campus at one time, we'll bring that route back on. And then the morning early childhood special education route decreased by about 18 miles. So taking all of that into account, our daily to and from school mileage is approximately 2,201 miles, which is a lot of miles. All of us just job getting our kids to come to safely and keeping their buses in great shape and maintaining the train. So those are the route changes. If you have any questions, just let me
know. I move to approve the bus route that will come to 2021 school year as presented. One second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have new business, assessment plan, updated testing schedule.
Yes, you've seen the assessment plan in your packet. Once again, we spent a lot of time last year updating the assessment plan. Really, the only addition to the assessment plan this year is on page 6. Row 2 is related to NWEA testing, K through 8. And that is our fall, winter, spring testing. I did want to say the MAP test, the Missouri MAP test, is basically a snapshot of what our students know, and then we don't get that data back until the following year, and at times almost halfway through the following. It's very hard to adjust teaching and know what you're doing that may not be meeting the students' needs, and what you need to adjust to meet those needs. The NWEA test provides us with a baseline, gives us a temperature check in the winter, and then again in the spring before we take the MAP test. Ultimately, we would love for the state of Missouri to look at a through-year testing model like this, which is why Dr. Fleet entered into this consortium of schools with the hopes that we would get some data back, be able to provide the state of Missouri with that data so that they can compare it to the MAP test data so that they're going to stick with the MAP test, the Missouri MAP test, we can still use this NWE test and it correlate to their data. So we would know who was proficient, who was advanced. So that's really the only change to the assessment plan this year. And I would ask you to approve that as well.
I move to approve the assessment plan update testing.
Second. I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have the amended budget.
So, in June, we did something a little bit different because the economy was unstable. It's something that the board has done in the past when the economy has been uncertain and unstable. But in June, you adopted accurate as possible on the projected expenses, but also build in some contingency money to cover the unknowns. So at the bottom there, I just always like to put our mission and our goal with the budget. So this year, we took the 2019-20 goals and accomplishments book, and we did scan that and upload it to Google Classroom, so you got that about a week ago. So you can look through it. That is a very large document. I would say like 175 pages. Basically, for those who've never seen it, it takes each building and it goes through all the goals and accomplishments that took place in 2019-20, but it also looks at 2020-21 and what are they going to try to accomplish. So then with the amended budget book, just a quick summary, I know you've had that for a week also and been looking through it. On page 2 is a summary of adjustments and additions. Pages 11 through 15, are the salary schedules. And just as a reminder, we adopted the same salary schedules that we had last year, but did allow our staff to move for 3 years of experience, our teachers, part of the additional college hours that they are. So pages 16 to 24 is the required 3-year comparison of revenues. Pages 25 to 79, the 3-year comparison of expenses. Pages 80 through 92 are the actual amended budget revenue projections. 93 through 158, the amended budget expense projections. Page 160 has our debt service payment schedule, and then page 161 is the amended budget summary. So, what I'm gonna go through here is basically the amended budget summary. So, the budget is based on projections, assumptions, and state of the economy. As we know, the state of the economy is unstable because of the coronavirus, and we're just not sure what's going to happen where we need to go. Of course, we're all hoping that the economy is able to stabilize and start to reopen, but we've all seen that happen. So this budget, and you know, don't freak out too much, but this budget does anticipate deficit spending of about $919,000. So to understand that, you know, you look at that and you think, wow, that is a huge number. That is not typical for the district. The first bullet under that is a debt service payment. If you remember when we did the tax rate last month, I told you that this is the largest debt service payment that we've had, which is $2.5 million. So in anticipation of that, and knowing that we're going to have to cover that large payment and the interest that goes along with that payment, so the payment is actually, with the interest, about $2.7 million. We've built balances in debt service to cover this expense. So what we're going to do is we're going to take approximately $575,000 out of the balances in debt service and make this payment in the interest payments. And we can't use debt service money for anything else. So that money is sitting there waiting to be spent. Okay? And then the operating fund, which is fund one and fund two. Right now we're projecting a $344,000 deficit spending. Some of those expenses are for COVID-related college, it does meet all state requirements. It is reviewed, it will be reviewed annually by our auditors and by the state, and it does allow the district to consider to be financially sound with respect to requirements. I have a big list of people that I want to thank here, building principals. They spend a lot of time listening and talking to me about items. Building secretaries, they put it all together with the principals, our directors, our supervisors, Dr. Green, and the host of payroll works with me throughout the spring, trying to set up all salary schedules in our software system. Carrie Bach does the same. Crystal Roth with insurance. Chris Ritter keeps me sane most of the time and on track. She's been doing budget for, gosh, 20 plus years, a long time. And then Dr. Taylor, he also does a lot of moral support. So, like I said, I know the deficit spending number is big, but the majority of that deficit has been intentionally built to cover the debt service payment and interest. And like we said earlier, other items, you got this budget a week ago. And so I know some of you have asked me questions, but you've had it for a while, so.
We'll do another amended budget in February, and then we'll.
We do another amended budget in February, and we use that as a starting point as I start working on salaries for the next year.
I know
you
talked about $919,000. You talked about the fact that we shoot high on expenses, we shoot conservative on revenue. In the past 2 years, I know we adopted a budget that's $500,000 or $600,000. $500,000 or $600,000 shortfall. And both of those years, we ended up black. So there's a lot to consider there, especially if we're going to get $200,000 or $300,000, hopefully back in COVID-related funds.
Yeah.
That'll do the gist of it. And we talked about the raising the debt service 2 years ago. And thank you to the community for helping us have all the stuff that we have here. And that's paying off this year.
Yes, it is, definitely. And those COVID expenses, they might or might not be covered. I mean, you have to the item and pay for it, and then you have to actually seek the reimbursement. So when you seek the reimbursement, you submit everything, and if it's an allowable cost, they'll reimburse you. But if they don't think it's allowable, they will not reimburse you. Or you don't have the documentation to support what you want.
You and I have spoken or exchanged communication earlier. Normal year, we carry 13. This year it will be down to 9. Awesome.
Our total budget, how many dollars?
27 million.
We're $4.5 billion in our budget. I move to approve the amended budget for the 2020-2021 school year as presented.
Second. I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have action for a closed meeting.
I move that the Board of Education hold a closed meeting with a closed record and closed vote following the regular open meeting on September 15, 2020, to be conducted at the R. Dayton Thomas Library, 715 Washington Street, St. Louis, Missouri, for the purpose of discussing and voting upon the following items of business. Hiring, dismissing, or promoting particular employees. Scholastic probation, exposure, and graduation of identifiable individuals. I further move that notice of this meeting and its tentative agenda be posted as required by law.
Second.
Motion and second. Roll call. Eric Bonhart?
Yes.
David Bova?
Yes.
Tom Hook?
Yes.
Jim Kirchner?
Yes.
Harry Gantt, yes. Michael Riesinger? Mr. Rudolph?
Yes.
Motion carries 7-0.
I'll move to go to closed session and close record and close bell after a short break.